not very often where you realize in real time how lucky you are to be getting to do something.
This has stayed really true to what I always hoped and dreamed that it would be.
More than any other show I've ever been on, it's been the most collaborative environment.
This is a real team sport.
This has been a glorious experience for everybody.
It changed my life, not only professionally, but personally. I met my best friends on this show, and it's been a ride.
This is all very serendipitous, and we're quite lucky to have landed on something that is so successful and so popular.
I'm not letting go of anything until I know it's impossible. If you loved me, you'd do the same.
Bill Dubuque wrote the pilot, and Bill grew up going to the Ozarks in the summers, but Bill is a feature writer that lives in St. Louis and had never done TV, so they needed somebody to kind of take the reins. So that's kind of where I came in.
Chris was instrumental in getting me in there, and it was a good story about a family struggling under very desperate circumstances, and I like that idea of the class struggle to birds coming from the North Shore of Chicago, very comfortable, very safe life, and dealing with Langmores and Snells and all the various people who ultimately turn out to be a lot wiser and a lot smarter than them in a lot of cases.
I remember very vividly it settling into this incredibly rich world, which is something that I think you're always looking for when you're trying to imagine yourself writing for especially an hour-long drama. You're looking for a world where you can project forward all of these vivid characters. And I remember the dialogue leaping off of the page and seeing it as really exciting, but also like a challenge, you know, as a writer, being like, oh, how am I going to help contribute to this really rich tapestry?
We hope that it's relatable to people in their own life. It just, most people aren't, you know, laundering money for a Mexican drug cartel.
I'm really, really grateful that we got to a finish line, the finish line that we wanted to get to, that we weren't kicked out of the party before we could get to an ending that hopefully is satisfying for the audience.
Jason they approached as an actor, and Jason basically said, like, I'd be willing to act in it if I direct it.
Some of those earliest memories were getting some of those initial first steps done, like talking Laura Linney into doing it, talking MRC into letting me direct the whole first season, and then ultimately not being able to do that because of time and schedule.
Now we just have to pull off opening a fucking casino.
I wasn't looking to do a series, I really wasn't. But it was really just wanting to see what Jason was gonna do. And then talking to Chris and being like, oh, he's pretty great. And I was like, well, okay.
I remember saying to the writers, like, oh my God, Laura Linney's gonna do our show. Like, we cannot suck. It's not okay for us to suck if she's gonna be on our show.
Obviously.
I don't think any of us had any idea where the show was going or where it could go or even if it would go.
You don't really perceive what the show is on the outside, but it's been special to see how many people love it and how many people choose to make the show a part of their lives and love all of these characters.
Everybody knew that the scripts were amazing and the people that we had lined up were amazing. Everything just lined up and it was just like this magical moment in a way.
That's right. And if Daddy were here, he would have hung you out by your ball sack already. You want me to tell him that you're disrespecting me? Didn't think so.
Probably the biggest tells of a good story is like the character creation. It's like creating characters that feel really, really authentic and natural.
Morning. Nine. I mean, we're spoiled in the writer's room because we have Jason and Laura. I mean, honestly, if Jason himself wasn't so incredibly likable, people might not have even gone for the ride at all. So I think we just start with a huge leg up because of that.
Chris always talked about the idea that the show being about the birds and the Langmores. And the idea that obviously, you know, the sort of the plot engine of the show is money laundering, but that's not the sort of the heartbeat of the show. This is a show about two families
that come from very different circumstances and seeing how they work with each other, how they're rivals with each other, how they play off of each other.
The Langmore family, which would be the kind of low rent version of the Bird family, and they end up are scrapping to keep their family together, despite all the difficulty and the violence and the crime that's been in their life.
The first season of Ozark was very hard for me because I'm not aggressive. You know, I don't have the confidence that Ruth has.
Very fun.
Shut the fuck up!
I'm working with Martin so I can learn how to launder for us. I'm not super tough like that.
Well, how about I pop those tits and squeeze out the silicone? How do you feel about that?
But the thing about Ruth that's interesting that I could connect with her is she's very sensitive.
I think in some ways the Langmores are cursed. It's the sort of curse of capitalism.
I think people see their families in there, even though we all come from families not nearly that screwed up in some cases, but we see elements of people in there.
Give me some time and bring him here.
You were clear and you have been patient.
Then you bring in the Snells, which is another whole story about those people who were displaced.
I think Darlene's normal is probably different from all of ours. I would say basically her life was kind of great until the birds came to town.
They would still be growing whatever those subsistence crops are someplace else that they'd not been uprooted. So the Snells are another family screwed up.
Hey, Maya, Charlotte, please settle Maya in for me and...
It's not how I saw my maternity leave panning out.
Maya is a workaholic, but only because she cares so much. So she's not just doing a job that is a clock in and clock out. I think that she is on a mission.
Eat something.
Omar Navarro is the head of the Mexican drug cartel that Marty and Wendy Bird get involved with. And so Maya Miller was somebody who Navarro realizes, could this potentially be someone else who could become an asset? And one of the reasons why he's able to do that is because he trusts Marty. And when Marty mentions to him that there's a possibility for this FBI agent to be an asset to us, then he starts to become more curious about her.
Season three really started as Marty versus Wendy. And by the end of the season, it was pretty clear that nothing could happen if they weren't completely on the same page.
You really want to do this?
You come anywhere near me, my family, or Ruth again, the next time you see your son, he's gonna be hanging from a bridge in Juarez. You got that?
The whole Bird family has had to get a little bit more creative in the things that they're able to justify for the ends. Marty's changed a bit in that he's a bit more ethically limber. He's able to justify many more things that perhaps the purer version of Marty would not in season one. If Marty was as allergic to breaking the law now as he was in season one, he would have turned himself in and we wouldn't have had a show.
Love you.
Love you too.
I have a very hard time talking about characters in a objectified way when I'm still doing them. Maybe in a few years I'll be able to look back at it and have a better idea. Wendy, she's complicated. She's loving, she's angry, she's hungry, she's scared, she's frustrated, she's all of those things that I think many people are.
I started shooting when I was 16 and now I'm 21. So I think Charlotte and I have shared a lot of experiences growing up somewhat together, but I think she's stayed consistently herself.
Jonah, who is the family member who was kind of most on board, starts having problems with the family.
This business kind of ends up defining their life, whether they like it or not. And that's just what he was good at.
In some strange way, because they've been through this insanity, they're the only other people that can understand it.
The important thing is, if all goes well, we have a promise that we're free of our obligation to him, okay? 6 months, we could be completely off from under this, okay?
One of the things that I think is most fascinating about the show and what draws people to it is the fact that nothing is predictable.
Ozark is a murder and mayhem show. And what more do you want in a murder and mayhem show besides chaos and excitement?
What the fuck is that?
There's always something to shock you and to talk about with your family and everyone else on the set.
Today's no day to fall apart.
I really miss Buddy. I still miss Buddy. I miss the character and I miss the actor. I miss Harris Yulin and I miss that character.
A big turning point was killing my dear Peter Mullen, who played Jacob, my first husband. I love you, Jacob. You just rest.
Ben comes to town and kind of either save Ben and we all die or get rid of Ben and everybody else has a chance. Chris called me a few weeks before we started filming anything and told me basically Ben's arc through the show. You know, he's coming to town, stop taking the meds, really start to lose control, and eventually you're gonna die. So I knew it while it was happening. So I really got, I feel like I got to really savor it, you know, in a way.
What beautiful human doing.
Beautiful.
What a beautiful day.
As far as who had it coming, I think that's gotta be Helen. She was just playing every single party in the Ozarks, just completely playing them.
I never saw you as the Ozark type.
We adapt or die.
I loved playing Helen. You know, people really liked Helen as a character. I mean, the audiences really liked Helen as a character. And I think part of that was because she was a woman. I really do think that, because it's more surprising somehow. And part of that because the writing is so fantastic and she had such incredible lines.
Let's not pretend we both don't know how badly they fucked you over.
I knew I was doing one season and then they asked me if I'd do one more season. So, you know, as an actor, you know if you're doing one more season, you're gonna die. I mean, what else is gonna happen?
I hope you had a pleasant journey.
I cannot tell you how many times we rehearsed getting out, the camera moves, the dry runs, as it were, endless amounts of times. And then we did it in one take.
It was crushing to learn that I was gonna be killed, and yet I could smell it coming. I mean, you can't keep someone like Darlene kicking around forever. She's gotta get her comeuppance.
I think maybe if we...
And then killing Wyatt, oh, break my heart.
In a way, he's innocent. He, I don't want to say he's in the wrong place at the wrong time, but he wasn't posing a threat to the cartel's business, but he kind of gets caught in the crossfire.
When I first learned that Wyatt and I were going to become an item.
That was awesome.
I thought it was very daring, a daring thing for them to do.
I've been around long enough to know what I'm doing.
I called Charlie, and Charlie laughed for a solid 2 minutes before he said anything. It just laughed his ass off.
Chris Mundy called me and told me a couple months before we started shooting, and we were just cracking up. I think he mentioned it started as kind of an inside joke in the writer's room when they were like, what if Darlene and Wyatt went together?
And he said, hey, I need to talk to you. And I said, what? And he said, and I said, wait, let me guess. I said, am I dying? And he said, yeah. How'd you know? I said, it is like a Greek tragedy. She really wanted to get out of that place that she was in. And she felt stuck, and she felt like she was gonna be here for the rest of her life. So I think she always wanted something better, but didn't know how to get it.
The decision to kill Ruth was by far the hardest thing in the entire course of the show. There was a point where all of a sudden it's where the story was going. There couldn't be no consequences. And in some ways, the birds had been this invasive species that came in and they wiped out, all the Langmuirs are gone. I think it would have been untrue if Ruth didn't go.
In our world, it's good to be one of the smart ones. Remember that.
The reason our show is so successful is the three people. There's Jason Bateman, there's Patrick Markey, and there's Chris Mundy. And the three of them working together have really been a remarkable trio.
I think the most important thing in any show, to me, it's the writing.
I've seen how everybody works and I watch how hard they work and it starts at the top.
Chris Mundy, not only is he insanely talented and everybody knows that, but he is the nicest person and that sets the tone for everything.
He is an actor's dream writer, which is someone who is open to responses, is open to suggestion.
He's so clear about the themes of the piece and where this goes and how you mislead this and do this. It's all so clever.
He really has been the architect of this sense of community that we've had here on Ozark.
You know, I'm just gonna be that cliche that just says it's like a family, and it is like a family. There's just not a person in the crew, in the cast, the van drivers, who isn't a really great person. And you know, it trickles down.
I can't reiterate enough how close we all are, from the top to the bottom, the showrunners, the producers, the cast, all the way to Grip and Electric, the art department, everyone. We all just love each other so much and we get along so great.
Nice! Oh,
yeah.
What I always tell the directors before they come in is that this is a director's set. Shoot just the things that you want to see in your cut, much like film set runs.
We've had some great directors. A lot of them I'd worked with in the past. There were people that we brought in the first couple years. You kind of try to figure out what the story's about by bringing in different directors.
Love working with all the directors and getting to meet all of them and learn their styles and their critiques on different scenes. It's really special because you learn so much.
I feel very bad for directors, guest directors who come into a show with a community of people who all know each other well and know the stories and have a common history, and then you're just the new person on the block.
It prompts much more preparation and much sort of finer execution from behind the camera and in front of the camera. And everyone gets really excited about that, I think.
I knew going into this, you have to do your homework. I watched seasons 1 through 3, I think 47 million times. See the different director styles and see where you can fit your vision in while still adhering to what Jason Bateman and the others created, the visual aesthetic for the show, as well as the tone.
The producers of the show take great care of me as a director. They take great care of their cast. They take great care of their crew. And that just makes my job easier and more pleasant.
Everybody was just fantastic to work with, but what an incredible crew. You feel like your foundation is so thick to have that many experienced crew members.
We've been blessed here in the last year with Robin Wright and getting Amanda to come back.
The difference between acting and directing on the show here is nothing more than the obvious. You know, as a director, you need to understand all four corners of every episode and every scene and every shot, every character, all their arcs and their motivations and all of the stuff that you might get presented with a question about.
I love working with Jason as a director. He's the best. I mean, they're all great, but I love Jason.
I should fucking kill you.
Come get yourself.
He knows what he wants.
Sit tight.
And he's hilarious. And humor goes a long way.
Stupid bitch! Come on!
And he's very kind. And he wants the best, always, for his actors.
I think that's one of the things that made working on the show really exciting, is knowing that he would trust the writing and we would trust the directing. He's incredibly meticulous. Obviously, he is someone who has been on set, you know, his whole life, and it is sort of, he has absorbed, he has soaked up everything, and he has a great passion for it. And he obviously brings that to the directing of Ozark, too, in terms of the visual style.
He set the look of it, set the feel of it, and then continued to keep that going throughout the seasons.
Like, there's a break in the lyrics there. Playing the guitar on that cut, that'd be easier thing sound-wise to blend.
Yeah, you have a good time with
from that? Season one, both Jason and our producer Patrick Markey had been pushing me to direct.
There were enough of us pushing and pushing, but she's so prepared. Actually comes out of theater training. She's so, like, there's nothing she's not prepared for as an actor. And then she was exactly the same as a director.
Her taste is undeniable. And an hour into the first day, everybody saw that it's just been, you know, like she's been doing it for as long as she's been acting.
I did it, and I'm very, very glad I did it. I had a wonderful time.
What?
Hey, talk to her like that one more time. I make a single phone call and have you killed.
What the fuck did you just say?
You heard me.
Just get back in.
I'm gonna repeat it.
Get back in your fucking car.
Fuck you, bitch.
Oh, suck my cock, asshole.
But I blame them completely. I blame them.
think the show's really efficient in the way it tells its stories, and I think it finds its beauty.
I think the visual cues of the show are so important because what you're getting visually sets the tone for the audience.
You're meant to be a little unsettled when you're watching this because this family's dealing with stuff that is not altogether predictable.
We're not a super busy show. We don't cut a lot. And the tones, especially at the beginning, were a little cooler. We always kind of wanted people to have to like lean into the show just the littlest bit, and hopefully it would be worth it.
The low level of light or the use of a fill side and a key side and the color timing and the desaturation and all of this stuff comes together along with the score and the editorial pace of things is to create, hopefully, a little bit of an atmosphere.
My job is to create a space for the actors and to create a space for the script. And this show is so well written. So I'm given so much information from the story and from the script.
The lake is right there, right? So it's always present in the background. So you always feel the world, even in these private family moments. And I think that does an incredible service to the series.
George has been giving us great, great things to point the camera at. All these years, our locations department's been great in providing all kinds of tasty, kind of gritty environments.
Another testament to this crew, the people who are able to put together these sets and everything. I've never not felt like I was in a hacienda in Mexico, you know?
The birdhouse means the most to me. It became a character unto itself. We were all so happy when we were there. It's stunningly beautiful.
This house is everything that was described in the script. We were really, really fortunate to get this, and our production designer, David Bomba, has done an incredible job in maintaining it.
Charlotte's bedroom that we do on the stage, and when I go in and look at it and I'm working on that set, I'm just reminded of the first time that I ever saw it for some reason. It really has stuck with me all these years.
I'll miss the Langmore trailers more than anything else. It's just peaceful. You could just go and spend a day out there, sit by the water, hang out, and like the most unpeaceful things happen there in the show.
And especially season one, there were a lot more of the Langmore family members around. And it always kind of felt like a party. Those lots of fireworks and fishing. And I have lots of fond memories from the Langmore trailers.
The Snell property just kills me. It was just my favorite place to shoot. I loved the house.
The look is very specific. Ozark has been able to establish a signature from the beginning.
The Emmy for Supporting Actress in a Drama Series goes to Julia Garner.
I feel so lucky and fortunate that I got cast in this. And I just love Ruth.
It's always nice to be recognized by your peers for work that you're doing, and a lot of those awards come from people that we know and work with.
I love playing Ruth so much, and every single day, I just feel so lucky to be doing this. And this is special. So thank you so much. I'll remember this forever. Thank you so much. Thank you.
The response and the support, the encouragement of the critics is obviously something that everybody appreciates. The acknowledgement for directing on this show was, you know, very humbling and surprising.
And the Emmy for directing in a drama series goes to
Jason Bateman.
Ozark.
I can't be holding this without a whole lot of people that make this show I'm so lucky to be a part of work, especially as a director. So thank you guys. That was big for me because that was what I was originally attracted to with this job.
Jason Bateman, Ozark.
Thank you to the writers of Ozark, the cast, the crew. I'm going to be able to thank in person tomorrow. Thank you.
The fact that people actually like watching it as much as we like making it, you know, is satisfying and just feels good. It just feels right.
And the actor goes to Jason Bateman.
I think we're all realizing that the end's going to be tough. I'm really glad Jason's directing it. That's where we started.
Coming off of her even works better.
Exactly. Yeah. This is a real team sport, and there's so many moments along the process where it can go off the rails.
This is like a family that we've been with for 5 years, so there's great memories.
When I first showed up, I thought the set was going to be the tone of the show. And it's the complete opposite. We're a bunch of knuckleheads.
We made a lot of jokes. Peter and I were at the craft table trying to pick out really gassy things to eat before we shot the scene.
We keep people fed. We keep